Okay, good morning. Yesterday I started to present the general approach of Wilson of renormalizing a field theory, starting from a theory with an ultraviolet cutoff taken seriously as some maximal energy scale beyond which the physics, we don't know what it is. So we start from an action at that level of energies, and we look at what's going on at smaller energies, larger distances, by integrating out degrees of freedom. So this presentation was quite formal, and I think you have recognized something that you have already been introduced in the statistical mechanics or statistical physics lecture, because that's exactly the same thing. Simply, I'm considering the functional integral with an ultraviolet regulator in the Euclidean regime as the functional integral that will be used to construct a quantum field theory instead of a sum over configuration that will describe some statistical mechanical system at thermal equilibrium. So, but that's the same mathematical object. Okay, so. Of course, this was a very general framework, and nothing warrants that this would work. In fact, it was one of the great insights of Wilson to show how you make this idea working and how we can compute for some problem with it. So that's what I'm going to do today for the 5-4 theory. So what I'm going to do is to perform a Wilson renormalization group for the 5-4 quantum field theory to see how to show you how it works. So I will not be doing, of course, a full renormalization group calculation because this has not yet been achieved in a general setting for quantum field theory. But I will use some approximation, and the approximation I'm going to use is I will be working in momentum space as we usually do in quantum field theory. And I'm going to use an approximation which is called the local potential approximation. Well, that's an approximation that is justified at one loop order. So in fact, when you compare the results of this approximation with result of calculation you would have been doing with a more rigorous result method at one loop, so keeping just the leading quantum correction to the classical theory, you show that the results coincide. And it's an approximation. So in fact, what I'm going to present here can be formulated in a more rigorous way in the framework of quantum field theory. In fact, there are two ways to formulate this in a systematic order at all order in perturbation theory. One is known as the Wilson-Polchinski renormalized action method, which is an elaboration by Joey Polchinski of the original idea of Wilson for quantum field theory in perturbation theory. So this was defined around the 84, I think. I still remember the seminar by Polchinski when I was a very young researcher. Well, he was very young too. And there is an alternative method, which is a method developed by a German physicist called Wetterich, which is the renormalized effective action methods, which has divided, I think, more in the 90s, and which is still very much developed. So I'm not going to explain what it is, but just keep those names in mind if you have questions or if you want to look at some more advanced literature to understand what's going on. Look in these directions. Google those names. Okay. So, remember what we did is that the idea of Wilson randomization is to start from a theory in the energy scale or momentum with a microscopic cutoff lambda, and to integrate out the high energy modes of the theory. So that's equivalent to making block spin transformation, namely, you know, integrating out the degrees of freedom at small scales. That's what I presented. So the idea is that you take an action at this scale that describes the physics for the field phi, and you renormalize so now you have a renormalized field phi s at scale s, and you have a renormalized action as at phi s, which is a renormalized action that we are supposed to compute, and now you are working at an energy scale, which is of course lambda divided by s, where s is a scale factor. So I'm integrating out the momenta from lambda to lambda divided by s with s, the rescaling factor. Okay? And I showed you how, in principle, we are supposed to do that. And you have a renormalized action, you have a renormalized field variables, phi s, because as you have seen, you redefine the renormalized scale by making some averaging, but also you need some rescaling in order to keep control of the amplitude of the fluctuation, of the quantum fluctuation of the field in the functional integral. Okay. And of course, what I showed you yesterday, the general strategy that was initiated by the idea of having block spin transformation in a statistical mechanical model, was to use discrete transformation. You start from lambda, you go to lambda divided by b, lambda divided by b squared, etc., up to lambda divided by s. Well, this is just a feature of how, in the space of theory, we move, in the space of action, we move by those randomization group transformation. But of course, the idea is, in fact, to consider S as a continuous parameter. And then to work out, to write this renormalization group transformation as a flow equation in the space of couplings. Okay? So remember, this original action, I stated at the beginning of the course that it could be formally written as an integral of a space of a sum of a operator O alpha of involving phi. So if you want, for instance, monomials in phi and the derivative with couplings kappa alpha. These are the couplings. These are the, what is called the local operators. Okay. And then, of course, if we treat S as a continuous parameter, we start from some initial kappa alpha. So this point is described by some kappa alpha, let us say, initial. And through this renormalization group transformation, you end up with some kappa alpha of S. the value of the renormalized coupling that describes the renormalized action. Okay? And, well, if you assume that you can treat S as a continuous parameter, namely that when you make a transformation by a factor scale B, the renormalized couplings do not change too much, then you can write this transformation law, since in fact the transformation where you go from there, this is just local. You don't need to know what has been, you don't need to know how you went to some effective action at a factor S here. You just need to know what the action, the renormalized action is here. You do a block transformation. You know what's going on here. So going from S to S prime is a local operation. So you can write this. Well, writing, in fact, I will consider a small parameter, little s, that is logarithm of s. Since it's a multiplicative transformation in F, it's natural to consider that the logarithm of the scale transformation is a little s. Then, of course, what you know is that, or if you prefer, if you write this, the variation of kappa alpha when you change a little bit s, it has to be some function w that depends only on the value of all the couplings where we are. So that's how I've write this as a, so that's a function of all the couplings, not only of the coupling kappa alpha, but all the coupling kappa beta for all the beta here. But of course, this function depends on alpha. For each coupling, you know how they change with S, but as a function of the value of the other couplings. Okay. So this function are called the Wilson, well, I use the notation W. It's not always standard, but I use the notation function because these are the Wilson flow functions. Okay? But you can see that, well, if you view the space of all the couplings as the element of vector in the space of couplings, you view the collection of coupling kappa alpha as some component of a vector in a big vector space. So W alpha are just the component of a vector. And in fact, of a vector field. This means that at each point here, we have a vector. And the sets of those equations writes simply S, the logarithmic derivative with respect to the scale factor S of the vector K viewed as a function of S as some vector of, okay, so you have your space of vector. At each point, you have your vector W, so you have a field of vector, and the flow that is generated by such an equation is just equation four, where you follow the flow with a speed proportional to the norm of the vector. So this is just a flow equation. And the renormalization group flow is generated by the vector feed W. Okay. Good. So keep this general picture. And what we are going to show is that those Wilson functions are nothing but up to a sign, the beta function of the renormalization group equation of the perturbative renormalization that we discussed yesterday. So let me announce the results. The Wilson function W alpha are nothing but minus the beta function of the renormalization group transformation. Okay. Okay, so now let's go for a calculation, real calculation. So now let me start from, so I'm using this local potential approximation. And so I am starting from a theory that is exactly like the 5-4 theory. So I am starting from an action of the form d dx, 1/2 of d mu phi squared. And then I take a general potential V of phi. So as usual, I am in the Euclidean settings, since the calculations are more simple, and we have an analogy with the statistical mechanical calculation. And so this action, you see, depends on a potential, and this potential V, V of phi is, of course, what is called the local potential. Well, local means that this term doesn't contain any couplings between phi at different points in space-time. So it's a local interaction. And V of alpha can be written, in fact, formally as, for instance, a sum over alpha equals 0 to infinity of kappa alpha phi to the power 2 alpha. Let us take it to be even. So we have a symmetry phi into minus phi, but that's just for simplicity. You can, well, if you prefer, we can take a general potential like that, you see? And well, if you are, well, okay, let's discuss. So for instance, you know, if you expand it to first order, we recover something like, we can write that this is some factor, I don't know, kappa zero. It's a constant. It will be the vacuum energy density of our system, plus a term that will be t over 2 phi squared, plus g over factorial 4 phi 4, plus h over factorial 6 phi 2 6, plus etc. So let me take a general potential. And of course, here, this is a vacuum energy density at the classical level for the theory. Well, this T is just nothing but the mass squared. This G is the coupling constant of the 5-4 theory. And those higher coupling are associated to higher, as we have seen, irrelevant, well, non-renormalizable interactions. Okay. So now, out of this local potential, out of this action, of course, I am interested in computing a functional integral of the form exponential of minus a of phi. Okay. Well, again, I put no h-bar, because if I have an h-bar in a quantum theory, I can always reabsorb h-bar in those coupling constants. Okay. So now we are going to use a sharp cutoff. A sharp cutoff to define the theory as a function of the cutoff. So as usual, I assume that phi of k is well defined. So the Fourier transform of phi in this functional integral is used only if k is less than lambda. If the ultraviolet cutoff. Okay, so this is the Fourier transform of phi of x. Okay? And now my question is, of course, remember, what is the renormalization procedure? The renormalization procedure means that, so, renormalization. I'm going to, I want to integrate over the momenta k between lambda and lambda divided by capital S. And let us take S close to 1. So 1 plus d of little s. So I am integrating over high momentum modes. So if you want, you see that I represent this is momentum space. I am integrating over a ball of radius lambda. This is the origin. So the field in momentum space, the component of the field in momentum space are non-zero inside this ball. And what I'm going to do is to integrate over this momentum shell. So let me, using the notation that I had before yesterday, let me call this lambda prime. So this is lambda, and this is lambda prime. Okay? So how can we perform this calculation? And remember, so what I'm going to do is I want to integrate over the phi that has this momenta. So what I'm going to do is that taking a given phi in momentum space, let me divide it into two parts. A fast component, which is defined for the k between lambda and lambda prime, plus a slow component, that is for the k less than lambda prime. So you see, so I decide that for a given k, phi is fast. Phi of k is phi fast of k if k is in this shell and it is slow. And of course, this by Fourier transform says that phi of x can be rewritten as a phi fast component of x plus a phi slow component of x. Okay? And so what I'm going to do is that in renormalization is that I want to integrate just on the fast mode. So let me assume that instead of integrating over all the phi to define the full functional integral, I am following the receipt of renormalization and I integrate only on the phi fast. Okay? Only on the phi fast. Okay? Then, of course, I obtain exponential of minus a effective of phi slow. Okay. And this will be the, if I know how to compute a, the effective action for the slow modes, then that's the first step of the renormalization group transformation I presented yesterday. So now, of course, the question, the difficult question is, how can we compute this effective, this renormalized effective action for the slow mode? What is it? Effective action. Effective action for the slow modes. Okay? And there, I go back to what we did in perturbation theory. Remember, we show that basically when you compute the effective action at one loop, we met the fact that the effective action for a theory at one loop for phi was the original action. So in our case, it would be A of phi. That's a classical action. And then we had a one loop contribution, which is trace of the logarithm of the operator that was the derivative of the Hessian. Okay? And what was this term? In fact, so in our case, for an action of the form here, A of phi is just minus the Laplacian plus the function, the second derivative of the potential taken at phi v. Remember, this is a differential operator. This is a function. So this is the Hessian differential operator. Okay. And what does this mean to have this formula? It means that what is the trace of the log of this operator minus nabla plus. Okay. Well, you can express it in momentum space. This is an integral over x. X logarithm of minus Laplacian plus phi x. Okay. And remember that this is an integral over Hull space. And remember that if you treat the function second derivative of the potential at phi, if you treat it as independent of x, of course, phi depends on x. But if you assume that the variation of slow, phi is slowly varying in x, then this is just, you can use the Fourier transform of that. So you can rewrite this as an integral d dx of an integral d dk over 2 pi d of the logarithm of the function minus, well, k squared plus the second derivative of phi at the point x. Okay? So, of course, that's not an exact formula. This is exact. This is not an exact formula. But this formula is assumed to be valid if the variation of phi are slow with respect to x. So if you want, as a function of x, phi is slow. Okay. So we are going to use this approximation to estimate the effective action here, or the renormalized effective action. Because The only difference between this kind of calculation where you compute a full effective action and the calculation we are going to do here is that instead of integrating over all the phi, we only integrate over the phi modes, the fast mode. You see? So it's a good ansatz. In fact, you can justify that very easily, that if you use this approximation for phi slow, then a slow variation with respect to phi fast, but that's a natural approximation. We end up with the following on that for A effective of phi slow, which is that it is equal to first the original action for phi slow plus a term similar to this one, so 1/2. Trace means integral over x. Then estimating this matrix elements means integrating over the momenta. This, the matrix element of this operator will be given exactly by the same formula, log of k squared plus the second derivative of the potential we started from here at the point. Well, this is, of course, now phi slow at point x. You see? But, of course, since I am integrating only on the fast mode, I have to perform the momentum integration here only for the momenta in this momentum shell, this high momentum shell that is in orange here. So you see, you integrate only on the high momentum shell. Okay. Yes.
You wrote there the gamma effective action yes. that we have before. What yes. is the relation with that gamma and the effective action that you called A?
But it's not the same thing. You use this to derive this. In fact, well, you can show very easily that at that order. If you start from A, the original action for phi fast plus phi slow with a cutoff lambda, then you get an effective action, a quantum effective action, gamma of phi. Now, take this effective action or renormalized action for phi slow with a cutoff lambda prime, and compute the effective action for an effective background field. Of course, and restrict this calculation to background fields which have only slow component. We see here I have the effective action computed at one loop for the original theory integrating over the fast and the slow modes. Now compare with the effective action computed with this renormalized effective action, depending only on the slow modes, but compute it with this cutoff lambda. You get another effective action. Well, it's very easy that this effective action you get here and the effective action here are the same, because simply you can start from that, use this approximation, and then decompose the integral over all the momenta into first an integral over the momentum shell here, plus an integral over the rest. You see? So if you perform first integration over the momentum shell, or if you start from what you got with that, with this effective renormalized action that was obtained by integrating over the high momentum shell, you can recover that you can very easily that the two effective actions are the same up to terms that appears at higher orders. You see? Yes?
Another question. Could you explain again why that's a reasonable approximation? Because we know the fluctuations in the field are actually quite high.
Well, at a very, very crude level, that's a reasonable approximation because in any way, the special variation of Phi's law are at larger scales, that's the approximation at Phi fast. But of course, if you are very close to what's going on here, they are not that bigger. So it's really an approximation. And in fact, what really you have to do is to use this approximation, see what the result is, and compare it to the results of higher orders, taking into account. You can, if you don't take this approximation into account, then you will generate higher order terms like phi slows squared, etc. If you don't use this approximation. And you can repeat the calculation, taking the approximation one step further. Estimate by that kind of calculation what is the renormalization of this term that will come back into this term, etc., and see whether the difference is big or not. But it turns out that for what we are going to study here, the Phi-4 theory at small couplings, the difference is not that different. The difference is small. But that's, in some sense, an experimental fact. So I have no time to justify what it's true. So at the moment, just trust me. It's a simple calculation. I'm using a simple approximation, but that's an approximation. Okay? Okay, so here we have performed the first step of the calculation. If you believe this formula, well, that's something which is very nice because you see that the within this approximation, the action, the renormalized effective action, keeps the same form as the original one because you still have an integral over dx and some function of Phi's law that is local. You see? So you can rewrite the effective action for the slow modes as integral dx. 1/2 of d mu phi slow squared plus a renormalized effective potential of phi slow. You see? Simply, this renormalized effective potential of phi slow is the original potential for Phi's law plus this correction integral d dk over 2 pi to the power d for k between lambda and lambda prime of logarithm of k squared plus the second derivative of the potential at Phi's law. Okay? So we have just renormalized the potential. In this approximation, only the potential is renormalized. But it's renormalized in a bit complicated way. Okay? So, but now remember, this was just step one. Now, step two, remember, we have to rescale the distances or the momenta and the fields so that the cutoff, we go back to the original theory. So what we have to do now is to consider that renormalized, right, phi slow of x to re-express it in term of an x prime equal x multiplied by the factor s. Is it multiplied or divided? And of course, yes. No, that's the opposite, of course. So that the momenta k prime are k multiplied by s, and so that the cutoff lambda prime becomes lambda prime multiplied by s, which means that, but lambda prime was lambda divided by s, so we recover the original cutoff. Okay. So what we have to do is to write that phi slow of x, I want to rewrite it as s to power minus some anomalous dimension times phi renormalized of x prime. So I'm just doing a scale transformation both on the momenta or the position and the field. And but I don't want to want the effective action. So I want that the renormalized action, A renormalized of the renormalized phi, is equal to A effective of phi effective. And I want it to be of the form, still integral d d of x prime now, of 1/2 d mu of phi prime or phi renormalized squared plus v renormalized of phi renormalized. So in order to do that, remember, we make a scale transformation. Where is my original action? Yes, it's written here. You see, the original action is yeah, it's here. So if I made it a rescaling of x, there is a factor d here. So if you want, this becomes s to the power d minus 2. And phi, there will be a factor minus 2 delta phi if I make this transformation. So in order for this not to change, I must choose. I must choose delta phi equal d minus 2 over 2, okay? Which is a scaling dimension of the free field. So the same result as if there were no potential, okay? So this is how in this framework, how in this renormalization scheme, we must choose the dimension of the field. And then, of course, V renormalized gets a bit changed. So because V renormalized of phi renormalized is B, is S, I'm sorry, S to the power, the dimension of spacetime times the effective potential of S minus delta phi renormalized. So there is an additional modification. So you see there is a modification between the original potential and the effective potential by these terms, and then you have to rescale both the potential and the field, simply to take into account the fact that you have rescaled the position and you have rescaled the space coordinates and phi. Okay? But this is a rescaling of the field, and this is a rescaling on the potential. Okay? Good. So now, in fact, everything takes a simple form if S is just an infinitesimal renormalization. So we integrate over a small momentum shell of width, of course, lambda times ds, d little s. Okay? And because in this case, if lambda prime, if S is 1 plus delta petit s small, then of course we are integrating for the k between lambda and lambda 1 minus delta of S. And then this integral takes a simple form. The integral d dk over 2 pi to the power d logarithm of k squared minus plus the second derivative phi slow for the momentum k between lambda and lambda prime becomes simply there is a coefficient that is the volume. It's proportional to ds, of course, d little s. It's proportional to the area of the sphere in d-dimensional space. Okay, and this area is, so there is some coefficient, which turns out to be 2 over gamma of d over 2, 4 pi d over 2. This is the volume of the unit sphere in the dimension. The area of this shell. Then we have, of course, a momentum term lambda to the power d. And then we have simply logarithm of lambda squared plus. Okay, so that's, you can compute this function, but this integral easily, but it takes a simple form when the integral is. And so then the final results of the calculation is that final results, we get an transformation of the potential V of phi under such small or infinitesimal renormalization group transformation. And I'm going to rewrite it just as a differential form, because remember, ds is just a variation under the logarithm of s. So the final result is that if I start from a potential v of phi under a renormalization group transformation by a factor s, I get a renormalized potential vs of phi. And the renormalization group transformation for vs of phi takes the following form. Then I have a factor which is simply the dimensional space times vs of phi minus d minus 2 over 2 v prime s of phi. This comes simply from this transformation acting on the original classical v. Okay, so this comes from the just the classical part. Okay, and then you get the non-trivial terms that came from taking into account the quantum fluctuation that was given by this term. And this terms becomes some number A logarithm of well, if I want to be careful, I must have a lambda to the power d, and then a logarithm of lambda squared plus the second derivative of the potential of phi. Okay, with a coefficient A that is simply 4 pi d over 2 gamma of d over 2 minus 1. It comes out from this calculation, taking into account that there is factor 1 half, etc. Okay? So this tells you how the potential changes with the renormalization scale in this local potential approximation. So we have here a term that takes into account the fluctuation, quantum fluctuation at one loop and neglecting the grad phi terms. So that we can replace this by this. Okay. And of course, what I mean by v prime of phi is just d. V is a function of phi, so it's the d over v of phi, and v double prime of phi is just the second derivative of the potential function v taken at the value phi. Okay? So you see, this flow equation is the flow equation in the space of potentials functions, v of phi, so functions that to a given value phi associate v of phi, so it's a function on the real line. And this flow equation is a partial differential equation. It involves on the right-hand side, on the left-hand side, derivative with respect to s. And on the right-hand side, derivative of the potential v itself. So you can view Vs of phi as both a function of phi and of s. And it's linear in log s, so it's a partial differential equation that is linear and first order in log s. So it's a flow equation, but it is nonlinear and involves, in addition, the second derivative of the second order in phi. And I'm sorry, because I am not showing you what I am writing. You see, this is a partial differential equation that is linear in log s and first order, but that is nonlinear because it involves the log of this plus the second derivative, and it involves the second derivative with respect to phi. So it's a already a non-trivial equation. Yes? Why?
Why you choose the scaling dimension as
B? Pardon? I'm sorry.
The scaling dimension, so like in the step two.
Why should I rescale phi? That's in order to keep the term of order 1/2 d phi when I am rescaling the distance. So if I am rescaling the distance without rescaling the phi, I get a factor s to the power d coming from the fact that you have an integration over x, and a factor s minus 2 because there are derivatives with respect to x. So if, since I want to compare the potential for the renormalized action at different scales, I want to keep this term the same order. Otherwise, I'm not comparing things that are expressed in the same scale. It's as simple as that. It means that if I am going to compare things at the meter scale and the kilometer scale, well, I have to be careful in which scale I'm expressing the field. The field has a dimension. So if I make going from one scale to another one, I must remember that I must change the dimension of the field. Okay? Good. Okay, so we have a very nice formula, a very nice flow equation. That contains the effect of the quantum fluctuation at one loop with this approximation of the local potential that we neglect the renormalization of the terms involving derivative of the field at that order. It turns out that at one loop, that's a good approximation. But in general, it will not be a good approximation. Okay. So now, of course, this is a very general equation. We haven't considered what is the exact form of the potential. And in fact, this equation comes out in many areas of statistical physics and of quantum field theory, not only renormalization of quantum field theory, because you may take potential that have nothing to do with the physics of the standard model or the X model. Okay. But let me discuss that. So, yes?
When you say that these are quantum fluctuations at one loop.
Yes.
That's, can we interpret that? Because when you said it was a saddle point approximation for the interval.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
But we're not making expansion in orders of h bar here.
Yes.
Like in the case that we did with effective factors. Right?
Yes. So basically, what I'm stating is that if you do the calculation, I did this calculation a bit in shortcut, showing you by analogy, you get this result. If you are careful, but this takes more time, you can expand phi into phi fast plus phi slow, keeping phi slow fixed. You estimate the integral over the phi fast by a saddle point approximation, keeping only the first order, perform Gaussian integration, do the calculation, and at the end, you get this. So this is, in fact, the result of a Gaussian integration around phi slow. You see.
My question is, why can I interpret that as a quantum correction?
Well, we are taking into account the quantum effects because we are taking into account the effect of the fluctuation of phi in the functional integral. we are starting to take into account the contribution of the non-classical configuration of the field in the functional integral. So we are performing the idea of Feynman, expressing a quantum amplitude as a sum of our histories, not just keeping the contribution of a classical configuration, here a phi slow configuration, but the other configuration nearby. And we know that when you add their contribution, we get up the correct quantum amplitude. So that's exactly the same game, you see? Okay. So we have this very nice flow equation in the local potential approximation. Okay, so now of course we are going to apply this to the potential we started from. V of phi equal so let me not consider K naught. Well, it's the question of how the vacuum energy is renormalized in the quantum field theory is a very interesting one because it's related to the problem of the cosmological constant. But at the moment, I won't neglect that. So let me just write phi of phi of this plus this, keeping only the first three terms in the expansion. Okay? And of course, V prime of phi will be T phi plus G over factorial 3. This is a G. Phi cube plus H over factorial of 5 by 5 is T plus G over 2 phi squared plus H over factorial 4 phi to the 4. Let me, for simplicity, set lambda equal 1. So this means that I'm expressing everything in units of the cutoff. The cutoff is the unit of momentum, of energy. And of course, then the equation becomes this, but of course, then you have this nonlinear term, logarithm of 1 plus the second derivative of the potential in terms of phi, that you can express as the logarithm of 1 plus t plus g over 2 phi squared plus h over factorial 4 phi to the 4 plus et cetera. You see? And the idea is, of course, that, so you see, if you have only phi 4 term, you will generate, you can expand in phi or in powers of phi squared for small field, phi squared, I'm sorry. So that you get, for instance, log of 1 plus t plus, well, 1 over 1 plus t, g over 2 phi squared plus h over factorial 4 phi to the 4 plus et cetera. So this is the first term in the expansion. And then I get minus 1 half. I'm expanding in term of phi. G over 2 squared phi to the 4 plus higher order terms. So you see that in this flow equation, you get nonlinear terms that couples the different couplings. Remember, T, G, H are couplings of the theory. And this renormalization group flow will contain the first terms will be The first term will be linear in the T's. And the second term will be these terms will start to generate couplings between the nonlinear terms. Okay? So, well, it's basically an exercise out of this general formula that write the renormalization group flow equations for the couplings. So instead of writing this equation as a renormalization group equation for the potential, write this as a renormalization group flow equation for T of S, for G of S, for H of S, the coupling of the 5-6 term. Okay. Just starting from this expansion and keeping both on the left-hand side and the right-hand side the term proportional to unity, to phi squared, to phi 4, to phi 6. Okay? And, well, here I am not going to give the exact formula, but I'm doing here an approximation when I assume that both T, G, and H are small. The couplings are small. I'm dealing with perturbation theory, so that in fact, 1/1 + t, I can expand it as 1 - t. So that's an expansion. I assume that the couplings are small. Coupling and masses, in fact, T is a mass, are small. That's justified because we are doing using the one loop calculation. Yes?
Determining whether are relevant or irrelevant?
You will see what's going on. You will, here, I have operators. I don't know if they are relevant or irrelevant. I'm just going to see whether they are or not from the calculation. Right. Of course, here we have an idea of what turns out to be. But still, it's interesting. In particular, it's interesting to see how when I add this operator that is irrelevant in the sense of renormalization group, what is its effect on the relevant coupling? OK. So, well, exercise, you expand the log, you group the different terms. So this will be just a Wilson function for the coupling T. Okay, this will be the Wilson function for the coupling G. This will be the Wilson function for the H. And you end up with 2T minus G. So 2T is just the terms that you expect from that. And then you get a coupling plus G minus TG. So these are terms coupling coming from the one loop term. And then you have higher order terms, but we have no control. Then you get here 4G. And I am in D equal 4. This calculation is valid for any dimension, but I'm doing quantum field theory, so I'm in D equal 4. Okay. So at D equal 4, there is no term proportional to G because G is dimensionless, but I get a term proportional to H, the phi 6 coupling, minus 3. Well, let me write it in the other way. Let me first write this as minus 3 g squared minus th plus h. Oh, and again, when I'm writing this equation, I have renormalized things so that the constant a is set to 1. So it's just a renormalization of the coupling, which makes things simpler. Okay. And finally, for WH, I found minus 2H minus 15 GH. Of course, plus higher terms that I am neglecting because I'm working at order 2 in the couplings. So I'm assuming that T, G, H are small. I assume that D equals 4, and I'm working at order 2 in the couplings. Okay. So these are the renormalization group flow equation for the couplings at, of course it's at order 2 for the COE at 4. And of course, this depends on S. So implicitly, when I'm writing here, because simply T, G, and H depends on S. If you solve those equations, you get the flow for T of S, G of S, and H of S. Okay? So now let me show you the result of the calculation. And since I have some computer figures, that will be better than drawing a bad picture on the blackboard. Okay, so that's fine. This equation would stay there. Okay, so perhaps I should have the light switched off a little bit. Yes, can you? Well, perhaps keep some. Okay, so this first picture, no, not yet, zero. Yes, that's, I think that's fine. Do you see? Is it visible? Yes. So this first picture shows the flow in the plane of couplings T and G that are attached to the phi cube and phi to the 4. So here I have neglected the fact that I have H, so I am keeping just this term in the equation. You see? And so here is the renormalization group flow in the phi 4 coupling G and the phi squared coupling T. Okay, G, I took it to be positive from 0 to 1 because, of course, the phi 4 coupling has to be positive if we neglect phi 6 coupling. But I'm considering phi squared coupling that can be negative or positive. We can have a potential with 2 wells, very well. That's allowed because we have a phi 4 term. Okay, so here are the flow. This is a line where there is no G coupling. So this is just a massless free field. The free doesn't interact. No, not massless. This is a free field, but it can have a mass here. Okay. And in that case, the equation becomes just d over ds of t equal 2t. So in fact, the flow drifts you either in this direction or in this direction as s increases. This is a flow to large s. Okay. Now, when you take into account this term and these terms without an h, okay, you see that there is a flow in the G direction. And the flow goes towards the small G because there is a factor minus 3 here. And these are the general flow. Okay? And you see that there is a fixed point here that corresponds simply to the Gaussian fixed point of the massless free field. If you are there, you stay there. You have a massless free field. At all scale, it looks the same. If you have a massive free field, then you flow. Because if you go to larger scale, you are expressing the mass in different scales. So the mass scale has a factor S squared. OK. Now, if you are start from a point where the phi 4 coupling is positive, you may flow towards this region where the theory has a very large mass, effective mass, or a positive mass, or in this direction where the theory has a very large negative mass. And there is just one point here where you flow towards the Gaussian fixed point. Okay? And so if you start here, there is a point. If you start here, there is a point. So this, there is a line that is attracted towards the Gaussian fixed point in phi 4. Okay? Well, so this, if you want this manifold, here it's a line, is stable in the sense that you go there, you are attracted to the fixed point. Of course, this is what you met in statistical physics. This is called the critical surface. That's the value of the coupling G so that when you go to large distances, the theory stays massless, so stays a critical. Okay, but here it's formulated in a field theoretical language. Okay. So now, of course, here I just neglected what's happening when you have the phi 6 coupling. Now let's see what's happening in the if you introduce an additional coupling, a third coupling. Well, the picture becomes a bit more complicated, and I'm not sure I have a nice three-dimensional picture. I think I have one, but it's not very clear. But imagine that, in fact, what will be going is that this line will become a stable two-dimensional surface or a stable manifold. And if you are on this manifold, you are still attracted to the fixed point. If you are above this manifold, you flow up. If you are below the manifold, you flow down. Okay? So now let me just stay on this manifold. So this manifold is a two-dimensional manifold. So it will be, it will have two coordinates, the phi 4 coupling, G, and the phi 6 coupling, H. So imagine that I am adjusting the phi squared coupling, T, so that I am on this manifold. And let's see now what's happening on this manifold, on this critical surface. Here is what's happening. So now I am on the critical manifold. This is the phi 6 4 coupling. This is the phi 6 coupling. Since I have a phi 6 coupling that I'm taken to be positive, I may very well have a phi 4 coupling that is negative, because phi 6 coupling positive will always make the vacuum stable. Okay? So here is now the flow. So this is G. Can be negative, zero, positive. This is a phi 6 coupling. You see that the flow structure is quite interesting. You are turning around this point, and if G is negative, you flow away from the line where H equals zero. And if G is positive, you flow on towards the surface. That comes, of course, from the fact that you have a factor minus 2h here, and you have a factor that comes from the sign of the different factors. Okay? And you see again that you recover the fixed point that is Gaussian. Both h and g are equal to zero. You see? So anywhere you start here, you finish on the Gaussian fixed point. But you see that there is a big difference between what's happening with the H coupling and the G coupling. So if you start from here, you flow very quickly toward the vicinity of this axis where the phi 6 coupling is negligible, is very small. And then you flow, but much more slowly, towards the fixed point. So here G, H is zero. G is over the one, and then it flows. And it comes, of course, from the fact that the flow equation contains a linear term in H with a negative signs. So that's why you are attracted. While the Wilson function, so the flow for the phi 6 coupling, contains a minus sign, so you are attracted towards the fixed point, but with a coefficient which is very small. It's not linear when G is positive. So you see that you have this Gaussian fixed point, but the coupling H is called what is called an irrelevant coupling. G is called a marginally irrelevant coupling because you are flowing very, very slowly. Do this. You see? Okay, so I don't think I have the picture in three dimensions, so that's good. And finally, you see that the calculations that we did, let me erase this. The calculation that we did, so the calculation that we did shows you that indeed, in fact, if you are interested into what are the properties of our quantum field theory at energy scales much, much less than the ultraviolet cutoff, so at energy scales S, I'm sorry, at energy scale mu, much, much less than lambda, which means that you have to perform a renormalization group transformation with S equal lambda divided by mu, much, much larger than one. Whatever is the theory at the scale of the ultraviolet cutoff, what is the microscopic theory? You can neglect the phi 6 coupling. One can forget about the H phi 6 coupling because H is called an irrelevant coupling. But you cannot forget about the G phi 4 coupling because G is marginal. Okay? Yes?
Flow to very large values.
Well, if G is negative, well, at that approximation, you see something which is quite amusing, that if you take G negative, after some times, you come back with G positive. OK, but I'm not sure this is a very deep feature or if it's just a feature of the approximation we are doing. But you see also that the fact that some coupling at microscopic scale are positive or negative is not always very important. What's important is what's going on. Yes, I want just 5 minutes. What's important is what's going on at large at large distance. Okay, and finally, if you well here I made a calculation when for simplicity I wanted to have no phi factor. But if you do the calculation correctly, what you find is that S d d s of G is minus 3/4 pi² d squared, because this coefficient for d equal 4, what is written somewhere in between, is equal to phi 4. So you recover minus the beta function, beta function of the phi 4 theory that we got from perturbation theory. And that's not surprising because what in fact what we have been doing is exactly the same calculation, you know, computing one loop diagrams, but having in mind the picture of Wilson going from high momenta to small momenta rather than the picture of those renormalization in perturbation theory, which is starting from low momenta and taking into account the high momenta. So it's not surprising that you get a minus sign because instead of writing mu dd mu of g equal by beta g of g, where in fact we are interested in what's going on from mu going to high momenta. We are interested in what's happening when the energy scale goes down, hence the minus sign. Okay? So this picture is the justification of the idea of renormalization. It means that indeed, if you regularize the theory by adding phi 6 theory, you see, perhaps at a very high energy scale, well, in fact, people do believe that at high energy scale, the effective theory that is the standard model must be modified by irrelevant operator. They may come from, I don't know, additional grand unification physics, from additional dimension in the space is not four dimensional. They come definitely from quantum gravity effect, but we expect them to be irrelevant at our scales, because when you perform a normalization group transformation, all these effects, all these terms becomes very, very small in the effective renormalized theory, except those associated to the marginal or relevant operator. Okay? Okay, it's time to stop. I've still been too long, so thank you.